Well, let's begin the exploration that Matt spoke of. The coming of the Great War, I think, is one of our most challenging symposiums in that we're looking at a long span in terms of the years before the war, 1870 to 1913, 1914. That's 40 years. And so we have a daunting task to examine different facets, because one of the most vexing questions which we confront today is, what caused World War I? What caused it? How do we trace the origins that could have motivated leaders, families, individuals to fight this horrific war, which is often described as a catastrophe? And so in looking at planning for this event, we're going to be examining several different facets, from the military to the cultural to the political to international relations and so forth, as so well presented to you in terms of the biographies and the descriptions of our presenters' talk. So we're going to kind of wrestle with some central questions trying to unravel this, and I suspect if we've done our job really well, we'll leave with more questions than answers. But that will be an opportunity for you to dialogue following each presentation and ask questions that you think are pertinent to help you understand and the rest of the audience in terms of engaging this very important question. What caused the Great War? And so to start us off, I'd like to introduce Michael Neiberg. Mike Neiberg was born in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and he received his post-secondary education at the University of Michigan, where he received his Bachelor of Arts degree, and went on to Carnegie Mellon University for his master's and PhD in history. Professor Neiberg has taught at the United States Air Force Academy and the University of Southern Mississippi. He is now a professor of history at the United States Army War College in the Department of National Security and Strategy. Dr. Neiberg's academic background is in social history, military history, French history, and American history. He has published widely on the theme of war in the world, especially in the era of the two world wars. His most recent books are Dance of Furies, Europe and the Outbreak of War in 1914, published by Harvard University in 2011, and The Blood of Free Men, The Liberation of Paris, 1944, by Basic Books in 2012. In 2008, he received the prestigious Norman B. Tomlinson Prize for his The Second Battle of the Marne. His presentation today is entitled The Roads to the Great War, 1870 to 1914. Will you join me in welcoming Michael Neiberg?
Well, good morning, everyone. Let me start by thanking George for all the work that he did on this conference. Thank Matt, Laura, and the staff here at this wonderful museum, and thank all of you for being here today. What I want to do here is kind of start the conference by talking about the ways we think about and the ways we teach the First World War and why it broke out, as a way of kind of getting us into the subject a little more deeply, and as a way of challenging some of the ways that we think about the First World War. And it's been back in the news of late, and I'll talk about this at the end of the talk. It's very important that if we're going to understand how to use the First World War as an historical analogy, the outbreak of the First World War as an historical analogy, then it's important that we understand the war as it was, not the war as it has been remembered. And it's my own personal view, having done this for a very long time, that the causes of this war and the road to this war have been taught pretty badly. And sometimes I think of Niels Bohr, the great Danish physicist, who was once asked to comment on someone's paper at a conference. And he said, "I don't know where to begin. It isn't even wrong." So my own personal problem in teaching the history of the First World War has been that most college curricula, even when I design the curricula, don't leave a whole heck of a lot of time to think about causes. So what I'd like to do is talk about the ways that we have taught the war, maybe explain a little bit about why we need to think differently, and then at the end, talk about how we might or might not use the road to war in 1914 as an historical analogy. How many of you were taught some version of this, the main causes of the First World War, M-A-I-N? How many of you have taught some version of this? Okay, guilty. When my own daughters are ready to learn about history a little more than they're showing right now, I'll probably use some version of this. It's neat, it's catchy, it's mnemonic, it's easy to teach, and in my view, it's also at least wrong, if not at least misleading, and that it's dangerously wrong in some ways. Note too, as I'm going to go through this a little bit, that two of these letters, M and N, the militarism and nationalism in Maine, implies some sort of popular support for the war or some sort of popular push towards the war. So the general narrative, if you don't have a heck of a lot of time to talk about the origins of the First World War, and even when, as I said, I've designed First World War classes, I don't have a lot of time, the easy way to do it is to start in 1871, roughly, when Prussia unifies Germany and does the insult of taking away Alsace-Lorraine and also of crowning the German Kaiser in the Hall of Mirrors at Versailles. Not only does that seem to be the opening moment of this, it seems to provide all four of those M-A-I-N causes. And of course, as a professor or as a teacher, you can look forward to the moment in June of 1919 when all of this will come full circle back in the same room. Then supposedly from there, you get the end of British isolation with the events of the Anglo-Boer War around the turn of the century. And that somehow leads to millions of men in Europe enthusiastically, happily going off to war to avenge past slights to a nation's honor. But the story of this war and how we got there is a lot more complicated. And so what I'd like to do in the first part of this talk is talk a little bit about each of these M-A-I-N causes. This is, of course, the scene of Alfred Dreyfus's sword being broken in the École Militaire in France as part of the Titanic Dreyfus affair scandal. The general approach of this, those folks that want to stress militarism, is that there was something growing in Europe in the years before the First World War that turned European society unnecessarily militaristic. And the Dreyfus affair is normally cited as being one of these, when the army became above civilian control in France, and when in other countries, in Republican France, where this wasn't supposed to happen, and that in other countries, this kind of drive was going forward as well. But I think when you look at the evidence, when you look at what Europeans were actually talking about, the Dreyfus affair appears not really as the beginning of some period of militarism that's going to push Europe into war, but the high ground of militarism from which Europe then begins to back away. And this is, again, not an argument that militarism didn't exist in Europe, but I think it is an argument that in the years between, say, 1905 and 1914, that militarism was becoming less important as a factor in European affairs. And I have here the French Socialist Party, which is one of the forces in Europe, the socialist parties across Europe, driving against the trend towards militarism. The general sense the Europeans had in 1914 is that militarism was on the wane. It didn't mean that it was going away, but it was on the war, that it was, had gone away. Things like the big fight in France over the three-year law, and even in Germany, the so-called Sabern affair, which took place just outside Strasbourg in 1913, which resulted in the first vote of no confidence in a German government in history. So things were beginning to change. In other words, militarism as an explanation, it seems to me, doesn't get us where we need to go. Neither does the alliance system. This is a cartoon that you see in a lot of textbooks or a lot of explanations of the First World War. It has a little Serbia saying, if you touch me, I'll, with Austria saying, if you make a move, I'll, with the Russians saying, if you hit that little feller, I'll, to the Germans saying, if you strike my friend, I'll, to the Frenchman coming in and saying, if you hit him, I'll, and then the British guy coming in at the end saying, hi there, if you don't. The theory being that the war can be explained as a schoolyard brawl. Someone just passed me something on Facebook just last week, the First World War, if it were a barroom brawl. The theory being that everybody is sort of ganging up on everybody else. But the alliances had been in place for a long time. And as all of us who survived the Cold War know, alliances don't necessarily produce war. If alliances were a sufficient or necessary cause of this war, the war should have happened before. Alliances, too, when you take a careful look at how they're written, are almost always written in defensive terms. That is, if Party A is attacked by Party B, then Party C, those kinds of things. The alliances in and of themselves did not cause anything. The third one, imperialism. This is the one I find the hardest to explain as a cause for the First World War. Virtually all imperial issues had been resolved. Most Europeans understood by 1914 that most parts of the globe cost them more than they got back. The Morocco crises of 1905 and 1911 are settled peacefully for just this reason. Neither French nor German diplomats saw anything in Morocco worth fighting over. And French and German diplomats, even the Kaiser in the second Morocco crisis, was very careful to say, whatever we do, don't escalate this thing so that it becomes a matter of honor. The empire is not a cause of the war. Which leads me to the most complicated of the four, and I know Pierre is going to talk about nationalism tomorrow, so I'm not going to step on it too much for fear of stepping on his feet. I would not argue that nationalism is unimportant in European affairs in the years prior to 1914, but I would argue that nationalism doesn't lead these people to war either. That is, do Europeans feel nationalistic, or are there national feelings in 1914? Absolutely. Were Europeans ready to kill and die for those national feelings? No. The most famous example, of course, is the case of Alsace-Lorraine, taken away from France in 1871 by the Germans. And the one that you normally see attributed, this is, if you're going to talk about nationalist feeling, this is usually the one. The French were supposedly burning for revenge over Alsace-Lorraine. Léon Gambetta's famous statement, speak of it never, think of it always. The dressing of the statue of Strasbourg in the Place de la Concorde and black mourning crepe, all of these things. All of these things, though, are late 19th century phenomena. When you look at what's happening in the years 1910 to 1914, you see things like this. This, the top one, is part of a very famous survey done by the Mercure de France about the attitudes of young Frenchmen in 1912. And the Mercure de France was a little bit surprised to discover that most young Frenchmen, who had never known Strasbourg, Alsace, and Lorraine as French, didn't care about it. They said things like this: I do not think that this question interests the youth of today or the country, nor does it interest me. Rémy de Gourmont, a very famous French writer, wrote, I would not give the pinky finger of my right hand for Alsace. I need it to wipe the cigar ash from my pants. And David Starr Jordan, the president of Stanford, made a trip to Alsace in 1913 and came back concluding, no considerable body of rational men in either France or Germany desires war, or would look upon it otherwise than as a dire calamity. And the Russians and British were both clear with the French that their alliances with France would not cover an offensive war into Alsace-Lorraine. Were French people upset about the loss of Alsace-Lorraine? I don't doubt that they were. Were they ready to go to war over it? No. So, why do we still teach this? Why do we still teach the main causes of World War I? It has the nice four letters that even spells out main. It does give you that simplicity. I'm going to suggest another reason, and a couple of you that heard me speak here in March are going to see this slide again, and I apologize. It allows us, I think, to put the people of 1914 into what I've generally called the idiot box. It has allowed us to think of this generation as a generation of people driven by irrational impulses like militarism and nationalism, and tied into things that no longer apply to our world, like imperialism. So you get things like this great, this is from the Onion's Our Dumb Century desk calendar, given to me by my children for Father's Day a couple of years ago. The headline is, war declared by all, Austria declares war on Serbia, declares war on Germany, declares war on France, declares war on Turkey, declares war on Russia, declares war on Bulgaria, declares war on Britain, Ottoman Empire almost declares war on itself. Nations struggle to remember allies, and the one in the bottom right, area drunkard, declares war on Ireland. So what this is, of course, lampooning is a continent that had taken alliances too far and had gone to war for causes that it didn't really understand. Like all good satire, there's an element of truth here. But the point of having this in the Onion, of course, is to put it safely into that idiot box. We also have the wonderful BBC television program Blackadder, which I know some of my historical colleagues like to pick apart for historical inaccuracies. That's not really the point, right? The point here, at least in the one that I've got, this slide here, has Captain Blackadder, played by Rowan Atkinson. He's the professional British soldier surrounded by Hugh Laurie, who plays the upper class but very over-educated lieutenant. And then the man on the right is your good old Tommy, played by Tony Richardson. I'm blanking on his name, Baldrick. And again, typically of the British class system, nowhere in Blackadder is Baldrick's first name given to us, which is interesting. There are a lot of things you can do about this. This is Captain Blackadder trying to get out of the third Battle of Ypres by putting a pair of underpants on his head, sticking two pencils up his nose, and claiming that he'd gone crazy. That's what that still is. But when they're asked, these guys, Hugh Laurie and Baldrick, what it is that they're fighting for in this episode, they can't explain it. Baldrick says he thinks he's fighting because a man named Archduke killed an ostrich because he was hungry. The point here is that these guys are fighting because of some vague sense of nationalism that they don't even understand. And Hugh Laurie's character does a brilliant job of this, Lieutenant George. And then there is also the image of this generation as being overly militaristic, this generation of people who fought a war with outdated methods, fought for honor, fought for anything but strategic aims. This is a still from Oh, What a Lovely War, produced in 1964 by Richard Attenborough, the screen version after it had become a West End play, notably on the 50th anniversary of the outbreak of the First World War, as we are here approaching the 100th anniversary of this war. And the image here is of an overly militaristic society, Robert Baden-Powell, all of these things in Britain. And you see, of course, other images, probably many more images, that come out from the German, French, and Russian side. I suspect that the reason these images take hold, the reason that things like The Onion, that Blackadder, and Oh, What a Lovely War take hold, is because we would like to believe that the First World War is some sort of parenthesis in human history. It is some sort of backward sliding in an era of progress. And especially for Americans, it is a counterpoint to the Second World War, a war which we somehow have convinced ourselves was fought very differently, more nobly, for better purposes. And of course, there's an element of truth in that as well. But I would urge, I certainly urge my students not to take it too far. So, what did happen? And let me just go a couple of slides on this, and then I will talk about maybe some of the things we should be focusing on. Okay, this is the other thing that kind of fits into this idiot box theory. And when I talk about the First World War II people around the United States and around the world, the Archduke got assassinated, and somehow a month later everybody was at war in a way that nobody really understands and nobody really can put together. And it's hard for me as a professor and as a scholar to argue against this. As we're coming up on 2014, I'm sure a lot of you are too, reading an awful lot of books about the origin of the First World War, and I'm surprised at how few of them can actually make an argument. They can explain, they can describe, but it's really difficult to point to one thing or two things or three things that really lead to the outbreak of this war in some sort of convincing fashion. It's difficult. This is a complex and difficult event to understand. Another reason I think we go down to simple stereotypes. What we know, though, from the people of 1914 is that the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand didn't concern them, in the least. They said things like this: just another tale of blood in the annals of the ill-fated House of Habsburg. H.G. Wells, the writer, was sitting with a friend of his when he found out about the assassination. The two of them pulled down an atlas to figure out where the heck Sarajevo was, put the atlas back, and as he says, we never spoke of it again. They didn't think it was a big deal. Why not? Again, I think it's important to understand the world as they saw it. Well, one reason they weren't worried about it is that they had seen diplomatic crises of far greater significance come and go. And I think about this when I'm talking to my Army War College students. We've seen a little bit of this, I think, in the past couple years. War with North Korea seems inevitable. Then all of a sudden it drifts off the front page. War with Iran is inevitable. I've even seen newspaper reports in the past few years, you guys have too, I'm sure, that's given specific dates. It's going to have to happen by the spring for this reason. Israel will attack Iran by this date, or America will by this date, in the news media. Then it disappears. Same thing happened in Syria a couple of months ago, where it looked like military operations were going to begin, and then they just went away. And I think something similar is going on in the Europe from 1900, roughly, until about 1914. And I want to talk just very briefly about these four crises as examples, although there are many more. The Fashoda crisis from September 1898 to March 1899 took place at a little oasis in what is now the South Sudan, a small village, as the French were trying to conduct operations east-west across Africa, and the British were trying to conduct them north-south across Africa. Those two axes collided at Fashoda. It's a very well-known incident. The French expedition under Major Jean-Baptiste Marchand runs into a British expedition commanded by Lord Kitchener. And the two of them sit there at Fashoda, drinking Marchand's champagne and drinking Kitchener's gin and tonics, while the diplomats in Paris and London figure out what to do. There's talk of war in both London and Paris in 1898 and 1899. The serious diplomats sit down and say, look, there's nothing in Fashoda that is worth us going to war over. And they cut a diplomatic arrangement. What's fascinating about this diplomatic arrangement is that it goes from looking like the two countries are going to go to war to, within just a couple of years of this, the two hereditary enemies signing an entente cordiale. Right? This is the model that many French and German socialists use when they talk about an entente cordiale across the Rhine, similar to the one that just occurred across the English Channel. In other words, alliances are not fixed. They don't have to be put in place. France and Germany don't need to be at each other's throats. And if Britain and France can overcome centuries of hatred, Germany and France can certainly overcome just a couple of years. So that one ends peacefully. The first and second Morocco crises also, as you can see, go on a reasonably long time. And they both end peacefully. Again, nationalists on both sides clamor for war. Our honor is at stake. We have to do this. We have to do that. We have to defend the interests of France. We have to defend the honor of Germany. But in the end, they cut deals. And they're very interesting diplomatic deals. They trade pieces of Africa. We'll give you this bit of the Congo. You give us that bit. We'll recognize your rights in this place, and you recognize our rights in that place. And it's over. It's done. The Balkan Wars from October 1912 to July 1913. I often talk to students when I'm doing this. I often say, really, you can think about the First World War really as the Third Balkan War. It's just that this time the great powers can't stay out of it. In the first two Balkan Wars, they can. Right. So again, these crises that are coming up repeatedly. And the two things I would like you to note about the crises is, one, that they both go on a very long time, months, sometimes years. And two, not only are they settled peacefully, in many cases, the situation of Europe is better at the end of them than it is at the beginning of them. This may not be a way you want to do foreign policy, but in this case, it seems to have worked. So you get people saying things like this in July of 1914. The Manchester Guardian: diplomacy will have all the time needed to localize this latest Balkan war where it belongs, in the Balkans. And many people in Europe refer to what began, of course, as a war between Austria-Hungary and Serbia as the Danube War, for the river that flows between the two countries. Right? So there was a sense that the diplomats will do what they did before. Right? Everybody calm down. The diplomats will figure this out. There will be some international conference. There will be some international arbitration. And we'll figure it out. So one thing that's different in 1914 is how much faster this diplomatic crisis is, from July 23rd to July 30th. And remember what we call it. We call it the July crisis. We do not call it the June crisis. The crisis is not the assassination of the Archduke. The crisis is the delivery of the ultimatum. And that occurs at the end of July. And as I was, you know, just because of where I work at the Army War College, every morning when I would wake up and read the news about Syria in the past couple of weeks, something like this seemed to me to be going on. It was kind of eerie to watch this happening, where one day the news is very good, and one day the news is very bad. The morning news is good, the evening news is bad, right? So you get things like this. July 23rd, the ultimatum is delivered. That's when everybody starts to worry, as you guys know. It's when everybody starts to think, okay, maybe this one is going to extend. July 26th, Serbia responds. That's bad, because they reject one part of that ultimatum. The next day, however, Russia, France, Italy, and Germany all in principle accept arbitration. That is, we can work this out diplomatically, with Great Britain offering to serve as the arbiter. And then, interestingly to me, July 28th, the International Socialist Meeting in Brussels, the same day Austria declares war on Serbia, you'd think these guys would be talking about war, wouldn't you? They didn't. They said, if there's still a crisis in August, when we meet in Vienna, we'll talk about it then. Only one or two people at that meeting said, I think this is bad. I think this is something we should be paying attention to. And then, of course, 48 hours later, Russia issues the mobilization that really begins that chain of events. So as an historian, the question I want to ask is, what was different about 1914? Why did this crisis go the way that it did? I'm trained as a social historian, as George said. So I tend to downplay personalities. Doesn't mean I think they're irrelevant, but I tend to downplay them. I do not think that Konrad von Hutzendorf's desire to marry his mistress had anything to do with this war. And three of the books that I've read recently, that have come out recently, all cite that. I don't think the fact that Raymond Poincaré, the French president, came from Lorraine, had anything to do with this, which is also in all three of those books. Poincaré himself said, Lorraine alone, Alsace-Lorraine alone, should not be a cause of permanent hatred between France and Germany. I don't think the fact that the Kaiser had a withered right arm has anything to do with this. Right? There's something different about this crisis in July 1914. What is it? Let me give you just a couple. One, for the first time during these diplomatic crises, Austria-Hungary, the state that Konrad represents, is a victim, not an aggressor. Their Archduke has been shot. Even their enemies, the Russians, cannot possibly stand up for a state that kills kings, or in this case, archdukes. Austria-Hungary is going to have some room to maneuver here. And Konrad, who's been arguing for preventative wars against Serbia and preventative wars against Italy for decades, well, years at least, now he's got some room. Now we have the right to demand something. We won't look like bullies. We'll now look like a state just getting what it is due. And that makes this crisis a little different. It gives Austria room to maneuver. Second, Britain and France are not directly impacted by this crisis. That also gives Austria, and sort of by extension Germany, a little bit of room to react. We all know about the British example, the British arguing and debating whether or not to get involved in the war. Something similar goes on in France. This is a crisis between Austria-Hungary and Serbia. France has to protect its interests. France has to make sure that if Germany attacks them, that Russia will abide by its alliance. But the French aren't even sure if this involves France. Third, this guy, Helmut von Moltke, the German, chief of the German General Staff, as some of you probably know, has already made the calculation that 1914 is a better time to go to war than 1917 will be, when Russian rearmament is back to full capacity. Germany's relations with Turkey are good, meaning that, as exactly happens, Germany and Turkey can sign an alliance to give them an edge. And in this case, the Russians, led by their foreign minister, Sergei Sazonov, have decided that it might be time for the Russians to take advantage of this crisis, not to help out the Serbians, with whom they're very angry, but as an opportunity to get the kinds of things in Turkey that they've always wanted. Access to the Dardanelles, the Caucasus. What I think is really important here is that if you're an Austrian or German strategist, the circumstances to play brinksmanship, to take a risk, will never be better. The stars are not going to align this way again. If you're German, this crisis means that Austria will be involved. They're going to have to put their effort into this. The Ottoman Empire might be with you. Britain and France might sit on the sidelines. You might never get another chance like this again. So what the Germans decide to do is issue an ultimatum to the Russians. It's very interesting why they do it. The one problem in this, the Germans recognize, the Chancellor recognizes it, Moltke recognizes it. If Germany decides on an offensive war of aggression, they fear that the German people will not be with them. So the ultimatum tells the Russians, you have 48 hours. Tell us what you're going to do. If the Russians back down, which is, by the way, what the Germans think, then they don't have to fight a war. Austria gets to punish Serbia, and Germany gets to extend its influence into the Balkans. If the Russians mobilize, which is exactly what they did, then Germany can claim exactly what they do claim. This is not a war of offensive aggression. This is a war to defend ourselves from the Cossacks of Russia. And this is critical, of course, in 1919, when Germany is required to sign the War Guilt Clause that comes in the Treaty of Versailles. Their argument, not illogically, is, hey, this war didn't begin with us. This war began with the mobilization of Russia. So one thing I think to take from this, and it's hard to put into that main frame, if you wish, is that there's a lot of contingency going on here. There's a lot of ways in which this particular crisis is different from the ones that come before. And that's harder, I think, to explain. And then when you look at the outbreak of war and you look at the first few weeks of war in 1914, you see a lot of things that are just not consistent with that main interpretation of World War I. You don't see what you might expect to see. When I wrote Dance of the Furies, I looked long and hard for people who were arguing, thank God this war started, I finally get to kill a Frenchman. Thank God this war started, I've been wanting to kill a German for a long time. They don't talk that way. They don't talk that way. They talk like this. This is a defensive war. We didn't want this war. They use a lot of passive voice, which I also remind my students. War has been thrust upon us. The Kaiser says, the sword has been put in my hand. Right? David Lloyd George says, this war started without anybody knowing why. Right? A great phrase, a great way to get yourself off the hook. You get Paul Dumerge, a French soldier. There is in our souls the clear certitude that France did not want this war, that she had hoped for peace until the last minute and had worked for peace. And frankly, I think in the French case, he's got a good argument. He's got a good argument. At the same time, a Berlin newspaper is saying, one thing can be said of the German people with absolute certainty. We didn't want a war, and we have done everything in our power to prevent it. Again, I'm not arguing here that Helmut von Moltke didn't want this war. Did the German elite want this war? I think many of them did. But that's not the way it was being seen here. Popular militarism is not driving it. So you get things like this. Right? And again, what I've done here is try to transpose a German and a French point of view at the same time here. Right? Again, you don't see. This is a war for the greatness and glory of France against the Germans we've always hated. Right? What you see instead are things like this. We've tried to do the right thing. The other side was deceptive. This is why I think the Kaiser emerges as kind of one of the key villains. Most Europeans in 1914 thought, this guy's been on his throne since 1888. He claims to be a pacifist. He claims not to favor war. And in fact, the Kaiser could argue, since he'd been on the throne, Germany hadn't fought a European war. And yet he did this. Again, hard to fit that in. You don't see anybody, at least I didn't find anybody, saying, thank God we started this war, we can now take more pieces of Africa, which is what we've always wanted. Right? Those kinds of things you don't read, at least not in 1914. But what you do get are things like this. This is Katie Kollwitz's Die Eltern, the statue that she designed for the cemetery where her son is buried. And again, this piece of art is notable because it is not a heroic image. It's not a triumphant image. It's not even an image of a soldier. It is the image of the grieving, guilty parents over the grave of their own son, a very emotional sculpture. She wrote this letter to her sister in September 1914, shortly before her son was killed. One cannot hold on to any illusions anymore. Nothing is real but the frightfulness of this state, which we almost grow used to. In such times, it seems so stupid that the boys must go to war. The whole thing is so ghastly and insane. Occasionally comes the foolish thought, how can they possibly take part in such madness? And then she ends the letter with, but they must, they must. What Katie Kollwitz was articulating was the central problem of the First World War, in my view. None of the major belligerents had clearly identified strategic aims. That is, they didn't clearly know what they were fighting for. By the time they get to the end of 1914, the war has already become a total war for causes that are not negotiable. For strategic aims that are not negotiable. And I think Katie Kollwitz captured that perfectly. I don't want to spend too much time. There's way too much text on this slide. But what I wanted to just show with this is that soldiers are reacting in much the same way. That is, those people one might expect to be the most militarist are in fact not. And in the book, I've got a quotation from a British soldier who says, in I think October of 1914, he says, can anybody figure out where this war enthusiasm is coming from? He says, I know one person, and he jokingly says, and one horse, who think this war is a good idea. Right? Again, I would make the distinction between war enthusiasm, a desire to fight this war, and war determination, which I think are two completely different things. And I know Pierre's going to also talk about that theme tomorrow, right? Okay. I don't want to step on Pierre's toes too much. So let me wrap up so that I have some time to take your questions. And I know it's the first talk in the morning, so you're supposed to go easy in the morning. And before lunch, Pierre. Again, as this thing with Syria was beginning, looked like it was beginning to ramp up or looked like some military action was going to come out of this diplomatic scandal or diplomatic crisis, I just started doing this because this is what I do for a living. And again, I'm kind of a geek. But I was looking at the way that people were talking about 1914. And I just started kind of saving some of these things. So you were saying things like this, the Daily Mail. As the West considers action against the ruling Assad regime in Syria, we must take note of a chilling warning from 1914. I'm not really sure what that chilling warning is, and neither was the Daily Mail. The Guardian said, the Syria dilemma, we don't want it turning into another Sarajevo. Okay, again, you see these things a lot. George Packer in the New Yorker, my God, it feels like August 1914. I wasn't sure about that one either. Right? I mean, in some ways it does. I mean, I do this with students at the Army War College a lot. How do you use historical analogies? How do you know when an historical analogy is valid? Right? Step number one, and I know I've got some colleagues who teach in the PME system too, step number one is you've got to know your history. We must learn from the past when it comes to Syria. And this one from the London Times. The Middle East crisis is as ominous as 1914. Here's what I think they were getting at, even though they were careful not to articulate it. I think what they were getting at is those alliances might kick in. That is, if the US attacks Syria, what will Syria's allies do in response? Right? Again, Russia being only one of the allies to worry about. Hezbollah could be another one, which adds an interesting twist into the modern world, a non-state ally in the case of Hezbollah. I think it also meant, frankly, there was a discussion of militarism here too, especially in the European press, that the United States was too quick to look to military solutions, and that it wasn't clear how a military solution would produce the political result that the administration wanted. Imperialism. There was a lot of talk in the European media about this too, that America's real goal was to protect the stability of the Middle East, upon which, of course, the American economy depends. As I was thinking about these analogies, though, it occurred to me how weak most of them were. Now, I'm glad the Syria crisis ended the way that it ended, that it is without violence. But, of course, the one in 1914 did not. Why the differences? I think one thing we should be emphasizing as we push forward into 2014 and as we start to look for historical lessons that come out of the First World War, we need to look at this role of contingency. And by contingency, it's a fancy word historians use to talk about decisions that are made in the moment or factors that are happening in the moment, things that are unusual. They can be an individual's decision or they can be almost an accident of history that can come about. And Christopher Clark's book, The Sleepwalkers, talks a lot about how bad the information is that diplomats are working under, that the information is not reaching them as quickly as they need it to make the right decisions. That's contingency. That's contingency. And I'm not one of those people who believes that in the age of iPhones and Facebooks, we have solved that problem. Okay. So I think we need to talk about the role of contingency, the way each crisis is different in its own way. And here's the challenge for us as historians, and I know I face it. I don't know if John and Nick and others here who work with the military face it also. When they ask us about historical problems, I can't really give them clear answers, right? I'm not inclined to say, hey, this is just like August 1914, because it's clearly not. That doesn't mean that the historical analogy doesn't help illuminate things. Understanding the past, I think, conditions our reactions to the present. If you think of the First World War as this idiot box parenthesis in history, then it becomes very easy to dismiss it. It becomes very easy to confine it to a generation of people that just didn't know any better. It couldn't happen again. We're not militarist anymore. We're not locked into alliances anymore. There's no more imperialism. Right? I hear some of you chuckling, and I think whether it's the approach of the 100th anniversary, whether it's Syria that scared so many people with its analogies, or, as I suspect, that the world of 2014 is actually going to look more like the world of 1914 than, say, the world of 1964 did. That is, we're going back to a time that looks more like 1914. Acts of state-sponsored terror, rising powers, declining powers, great powers in some sort of transition, whatever it is that the United States is going through, that the world of 2014 actually might look more like 1914 than the world has in, say, the Cold War years. And third, I think we need to reject both this idea of an idiot box, and I think it's time to throw out Maine. I think it's time to just get rid of it and look at this event in 1914 in all of its complexity, as difficult as that is going to be to do, and to explain how this event happened as best we can, understanding that this is likely to pose more questions than it is answers. To do otherwise, I think, is to learn from an imagined past, which is pointless, both to understand 1914 and to apply 1914 to our own times. So thank you, and I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have.